Roy Goodman, host of Higher Education Today, a production of the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome back to the education program that connects you to contemporary issues, people, and institutions involved in the world of higher education. Today we'll be talking about NASA, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Leland D. Melvin is NASA's Associate Administrator for Education. He is responsible for strengthening student involvement in NASA's various missions. Mr. Melvin is a former astronaut himself with a BS in chemistry, an MS in material science engineering, and 3 honorary doctorates. Welcome.
Thank you, Stephen. Welcome.
Well, thank you. Well, maybe if we could start, I don't think we've ever had an astronaut on the show.
First time.
Maybe if you could say a word or two about how did you become an astronaut?
Oh, that's a good question. I applied. I filled out a government application, and I got in. No, but when I was a kid, I never imagined in my wildest dreams that I'd be an astronaut. And I loved math and science and sports. And when I went to college, I got a college scholarship to play football. Then ended up at NASA as a research scientist. A friend of mine said, you'd be a great astronaut. And I said, what are you talking about? And he handed me an application. I literally filled it out eventually and got a call to come interview. It was about 2,500 people applied, and about 31 of us actually got called to become astronauts that year. So it's a government interview, but all the things that I did in my career to get there, you know, research, played some professional football, did a number of other things, that gave me the building blocks to be a good team player, to have the knowledge to learn quickly, easily, and to be an astronaut.
Well, maybe if you could say a word or two about the academic preparation.
Right.
Because I think a lot of, first of all, it's kind of amazing that you just applied for it and got it. But for a student who's watching this show right now, I mean, they might be saying to themselves, wow, what should I study? How
right.
should I prepare for that?
Right. So as I said, I loved math and science. And chemistry was my major in college. After leaving the NFL, I went back to graduate school and got my master's in material science engineering, which was how you can take materials and build, you know, this pen or this wooden table or, you know, the plastics and materials around that we use every day in society. And I worked at NASA for about, you know, 10 years and then applied. And I think whatever you decide to do in a technical area, whether it's computer science, whether it's being a medical doctor, aerospace engineering, astrobiology, all these things, you have to find that passion inside of you. And we have so many different careers at NASA that you can do. But to become an astronaut is a technical field. You show that you are dedicated and you do some meaningful work in that area. And then after having a master's in 3 years of work experience or PhD and no work experience, you can become an astronaut.
Interesting. Well, you mentioned the non-science people. Who are the people who work at NASA who are not technical?
Well, think about, you know, when we eat in space, there is someone who's planning, a nutritionist who's planning our meals. So we have dietitians, we have cooks, we have people that actually make the space food that we eat. We have lawyers, we have, you know, doctors, we have writers. We have people that write the copy for our speeches along with the summaries for the mission planning. So the whole gamut of people can work at NASA. And people that are doing architecture, that develop the buildings, rocket scientists are there, you know, chemists, biologists, the whole gamut of people. And I think the people that you don't think about that are there, we have the lawyers and the business people that are making sure that we spend the money in a timely manner for our economy. But it's a whole gamut of people that work at NASA.
Well, fair enough. Speaking about the money, you know, I'm sure somebody will say to you, this is terrific, but, you know, there are a lot of homeless people on
right,
Earth.
Right.
We need schools. We need to fix roads. How do you address people who say that?
Well, there are lots of ills that are happening in our society. I think what we do at NASA, about a half a cent per taxpayer per day is what we spend for the space program. It's a $17 billion program, which has given us things that have advanced our civilization. I mean, when I think of the first human being to walk on the moon, Neil Armstrong, he didn't do that for America, he did it for our civilization. So when he went to Japan or China or different places, they all celebrated that feat of a human being walking on the moon. I think of the fire detectors, smoke detectors and things in here, hip replacements, you know, braces for people, heart pacemakers, all these things have been a benefit to our society from the NASA technology. And I think we as a civilization, once we stop exploring, we will falter.
Well, and speaking about exploring, I assume you have seen the new Star Trek movie. And Do you agree with the concept that we just keep exploring and keep exploring and keep exploring?
We must explore. I mean, you know, I think if when someone said the world is flat and we will sail off of it, and if we had never ventured from, you know, those original explorers, where would we be now? We would still be locked in a little island somewhere. So I think, you know, leaving the planet, what if this DA 2012 DA 14 asteroid had actually hit the planet, which could be a civilization-ending event? You know, would we have been able to take astronauts on a space station and then keep our livelihood going? So we must explore as a civilization, or there are things that are out there that could, you know, end the civilization, like the dinosaurs.
Well, in terms of the asteroids and the dinosaurs, I mean, my understanding is that's the explanation, is that people believe that the dinosaurs left the Earth because of an asteroid.
Right.
In your view, is that true? And two, how likely is it that an asteroid will hit Earth in the next 100 years?
Well, we've had, you know, on my birthday, February 15th, just recently, we had a meteor come down and do quite a bit of damage in Russia. And on that same day, this other one, DA 2012 DA 14, whizzed by the planet at about 17,000 miles. So this was below the geostationary satellites to give you your HBO and your Showtime. So we were very close to being hit. We weren't hit. And I think if we have an event there is a significant, you know, 2 kilometer size asteroid that hits, we have acid rain, we have oceans boiling, we have a number of things that are happening to our planet that we may not be able to recover from. So we must continue to search for these things, we must explore. And that's one of the NASA's current missions, is to go look for an asteroid, bring it close to cislunar orbit near the moon, and then actually mine it, bring it back, send astronauts there, bring back minerals from that asteroid to see, you know, the former origins of life. And then that will help us also get ready for going to Mars.
Well, and in terms of Mars, I mean, how serious is it likely that in our lifetime there's going to be travel to Mars for humans?
In our lifetime, we're working on that now. We're thinking, you know, the 2035 time frame. Hopefully we can get our rockets together. We're working on an Orion capsule right now. Lockheed Martin and NASA partnered together. Will be next year, we'll launch that off to space, and that will be the human capsule. We're building also a space launch system that will, the big rockets that will take us there. So we're planning that, we're working on that. But I think, you know, as again, back to that civilization piece, as a civilization, we need to look for inhabiting another planet, another body, because what if something does happen to our home planet? And we're trying to mitigate all those things from happening, but, you know, what if?
Well, that's an interesting hypothesis, because you're essentially, you know, most people are planning for what happens if they lose their jobs, what happens if they don't get an A in their math class,
right.
But you're planning for the end of civilization on Earth and, you know, whether or not we should go to Mars.
I'm not planning for that, but I mean, you have a contingency plan, you know, the what ifs. And, you know, when I flew in the space shuttle, as we launched, you know, we have, you know, three bits of redundancy in case something fails, you know, 3 auxiliary power units, you know. 3 engines, you know, we always have a backup plan for that. So I just think we must be ready for these types of events.
But how would, my understanding, of course, is far less sophisticated than yours in terms of space travel, but my understanding is that the difficulty in terms of traveling from here to Mars is the issue of the radiation.
Right, that's one of the big concerns. And we actually kicked off a program, a K-12 program for students to build a radiation shield that will fly next year on the Orion capsule that's going up to space. And so if you think about astronauts going to space, going to Mars for an 8-month trip, how can your body withstand the solar radiation that's attacking your body? Either you build a big enough vehicle that has enough shielding, or you cut the time down so that your exposure there is shortened. And those are some of the problems we're working on right now.
Well, what about the issue of space travel from the perspective of tourism or private people as opposed to government agencies?
Well, we've been working with a number of agencies, namely SpaceX, Virgin Galactic, Blue Origin. We've all, you know, funded them to kick off their commercial sector. You know, Richard Branson with Virgin Galactic is going to be flying, hopefully in the next year or two, tourists to space. We've flown tourists to space on the International Space Station, from Charles Simoni to Dennis Tito, you know, spending a week. Even Guy Liberté, who was the guy from Cirque du Soleil, went to the space station, did some experiments, kicked off programs around water. They paid a fairly hefty price tag to be in space for a month, I mean for a week, but you know the prices that Virgin and these other companies are looking at are much more cost effective, and people want to get married in space, you know. So that's a suborbital flight going around the planet, getting weightless for 25 seconds around, you know, going around. Yeah, it's something that some people can afford to do and would like to do.
Well, that's interesting. I wonder what you put on your marriage certificate. Where's the place of wedding?
Intergalactic wedding ceremony.
That's really interesting. But in terms of people who are, let's say, doing things like getting married in space, how does that actually happen? Can someone send you a letter and say, I'd like to get married in 10 years?
Well, I think, you know, right now, as I said, Richard Branson and Virgin Galactic, they're planning to fly tourists to space. I think a number of people have signed up for those first flights. I think it's, I don't know the number, but it's about $200,000 or $300,000 to fly suborbital, and that's going weightless for maybe an hour or so. So they could, you know, there could be a justice of the peace on the vehicle, and they could get married and, you know, do that.
Well, if you don't mind me asking you, what does it feel like when you're in space?
In space? It's one of the most incredible feelings because it's like you're floating in the ocean, but there's nothing touching you, and there's no water on you. And when we first got to space, my first flight in 2008, I was, we're sitting in a seat somewhat like this, it was a 5-point seatbelt, the engine shut off, and now you feel like you're falling forward because there's no more acceleration taking you forward. So your vestibular system is still thinking that you're moving forward. And once you start looking around and seeing things floating around you, though this pin is now floating up by you that you dropped on the floor, you feel this sense of awe and wonder. You look out the window, you're going around the planet at 17,500 miles per hour. Every 90 minutes, you go around the planet. You see a sunrise and a sunset every 45 minutes. And the planet has the most incredible colors in the Caribbean, the blues, the browns, and the white snow-capped mountains. And your body is now adjusting to this weightless environment where your vestibular system is no longer working. So all your cues for orientation have to do with your eyes. And that transition takes about maybe from 10 to 15 to 30 minutes. Some people get sick in space. We call that space flight awareness. And you start working and doing your job like you were training on the ground to do. But it's one of the most incredible things when you have people that used to fight against on the planet. And now you're working together in space. You know, I was in space with Russians and Germans, the first female commander of the International Space Station. And so you see these people working as a team, advancing civilization, while there's things on the planet still going on, social unrest, strife, whatever. As you go over those countries, you know what's happening in Afghanistan, you know what's happening in Iran, you know, but you're working with people from all around the world to advance civilization.
Well, that's an interesting point, because if you think about a lot of science fiction, in a lot of science fiction, it's about future civilization when the human civilization is essentially at peace with itself.
Right. Well, Star Trek. I mean, they're going out to explore the unknown and, you know, the 5-year mission to help advance civilization. You know, Tribbles and Klingons and all these different things are there working, trying to work together.
Well, what about a student who says, wow, this is really exciting. This is kind of interesting. So can you walk us through a little bit more about what your day-to-day training was like when you became an astronaut? Because I think you made it sound easy, but I'm sure it wasn't easy.
Right, no, and again, I, for my case, you know, I had done a lot of things in my career. I had done, you know, program management, I'd done research, I'd done, you know, sports teams, professional sports teams, and worked together with other people. So I think when I was interviewed, they had seen that I had done a lot of high impact things with, you know, aerospace programs, with NASA, and with also a high performing professional football team, the Detroit Lions and the Dallas Cowboys. So, but you know, once you decide on what you want to do with your career, whether it's mechanical engineering or, you know, biology or chemistry, then you work on, you know, being the best that you can be, choosing problems and things that can help advance our civilization or things that you're very interested in. And then once you progress in your career, let's say you have a PhD in astrobiology and you want to publish papers and work at a university, and then you say, well, maybe I want to be an astronaut. You apply, you fill out that form, apply to the astronaut corps, and then you go through a series of interviews, physical testing, mental testing, you know, psychological testing, and also testing on how well you would do in the spacesuit. You know, we have a a system where you're put in one of the EMU, the EVA suits, spacewalk suits, and you're actually suspended to simulate as though you were in weightlessness. And they give you tools, they have you turning bolts and fixing things. We give you tests on robotics, how you can, you know, fly a robotic arm on a simulator, which is exactly like what we did in space. And so aptitude tests, different things, how well you work as a team member. You know, we would interview people that you've worked with to see how well you would behave in a high-stress environment with people that sometimes don't sound like you or don't look like you.
Well, and speaking of not sounding like you, you may not even know the first language of the person who you're flying with.
Right. Now, everyone is supposed to know English on the International Space Station, but we all take Russian and other languages to, you know, to help with the people coming together.
Fascinating. In terms of preparation for what you don't know, mm-hmm. So I like what you just said a second ago about kind of the simulation and then trying to get ready for what you life would be like in space.
Right.
But I'm intrigued by the notion of how do you prepare for what you don't know?
Right. I think, you know, you have a basic set of skills. You know, where if you're doing a spacewalk, you know that you're going to be working with tools. You know that you're going to have to translate down the modules of the International Space Station. You know you may have to repair a solar array. And we had a case where we had never repaired a solar array before, but we had to improvise where we had this robotic arm, which astronauts usually ride on the end of and go do tasks. But the solar arrays were so far that the robotic arm wouldn't reach. So then we attached an astronaut to the end of an inspection boom on the end of the robotic arm, had never done it before. And so we improvise as we go along. And that's what creativity and innovation bring you. They bring you the ability to improvise on the spot with the tools that you have. That's why art and music are so important to science. And so we talk about STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math, but sometimes we add the A in there for the arts because, again, when I was in space the first time, Quincy Jones, you know, world-renowned producer and musician, he said to me, math and music are the only two true absolutes that use both the right and left side of the brain. So if you know math, you know music. So anyway, art is very important in that too, being the creativity.
Fair enough. But that was an interesting response. I was actually thinking of something a little bit different, which was the issue of scary things that happened in space.
Such as?
Such as another civilization that we don't know anything about, or people who are not coming in peace.
So hopefully we choose the right people that would be the best ambassadors to not want to have this warring nation want to war in those astronauts, right? I mean, you know, but if they're coming not in a peaceful manner, then you have to utilize the tools that you have to defend yourself. In this case, you know, we don't take a photon torpedo with us on the space station or the Soyuz rocket, but, you know, those are things we have to make sure that we can be prepared for.
Well, the reason in particular that interested me was because I was recently in West Virginia, and mm-hmm. there's a listening station in West Virginia that listens for sounds from outer space.
Right.
But if I understood this correctly, they specifically said, we don't send sounds into space for precisely this concern.
Because, well, it depends on what you send, right? If you're sending, you know, we come in peace signs and images. I mean, I remember the movie Contact, where the signal was coming down, it was the machine that, you know, we built, and we ended up making contact with this civilization. But I don't know of all the satellite stations around the country that are sending, if they're sending things up. I'm sure there's someone that's sending something up about a peaceful signal from our planet. I'm sure of that.
Interesting.
I mean, the Voyager missions have a plate, a gold plate that has the human torso, like the Michelangelo's body, and other things in different languages, and cryptograms and symbols showing who we are, where we are in our solar system, and words about coming in peace.
Well, interesting. in terms of the coming in peace, if we can just get on that just a teeny bit and stay on that a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
So, but NASA is a civilian space entity.
Right.
But there must be some sort of top secret or secret things that go on that you can't talk about and or that interact with the military in some way.
Well, we used to do a lot more with deploying military satellites back in the 70s and the 80s. And since then, you know, the Department of Defense has now their own space program. So they can launch and send and do things that we don't have to do anymore with our space shuttle. but we're primarily now more of a civilian, truly a civilian agency that's doing things of more, you know, advancing civilization, Earth observation, how do we go to other planets and other moons.
Well, and in terms of getting there, my understanding is that space debris is a real problem.
It's a huge problem. It is. You know, with all of the defunct satellites up there now that are, they've spent their fuel, some are spinning out of control. There are things that are colliding with them. You know, they're a 2.5 centimeter diameter object moving at 7 miles per second can just obliterate something and cause it to, you know, go into thousands of pieces. And then all those pieces can generate more debris. And so we're having to monitor that debris field, especially in low Earth orbit where the space station is, to ensure that if we have to do a maneuver to mitigate a hit to the station, which could mean deorbiting the station and losing the station. So we're constantly monitoring that. NORAD and the people out west are actually constantly looking in our environment for those kind of things.
Well, is there a way to clean it up rather than just kind of avoid it?
That's a good question. I know that there have been a lot of conferences about orbital debris and how we can actually send a sweeper up there to grab pieces. But you know, to transfer from one orbit to another orbit, it's a lot of fuel, a lot of cost. And so I think the main thing would be to, if you know that a satellite is going to be defunct or going to be, you know, out of its useful lifetime, to have it deorbit instead of, you know, having it sit there. So I think there are ways to mitigate that also.
Fair enough. In terms of contractors, we talked about the people who work at NASA, mm-hmm. but I'm assuming that there are tons of contractors who provide all sorts of services to NASA. How does one work for those contractors?
So there are support service contractors that do things from secretarial work to clerical support to actually contractors that are working on, you know, building the next rocket with us. So it's, I think, you know, when you apply to become a NASA civil servant, there are also contracting staff that are looking to see if you can work, you know, side by side with civil servants. I mean, we have people that work in our office that you don't know who's a civil servant and who's a contractor because we're so integrated in that way.
And do you just go to the, now that you're wearing a suit, I guess you're not a civilian because you're a former astronaut, but in some ways
I'm a civilian.
You're a civilian now?
I wasn't a military astronaut. We had about a third of the astronauts are military, about two-thirds are civilian. And so those, in the past, those were astronauts that were military test pilots that had flown 45 to 50 different airplanes and had come from that test background. And then those would be the ones that would actually fly the vehicle. They would be the commander or the pilot flying the vehicle. The rest of us were civilians or even military backseaters that would do, you know, like they would be the bombing people, and they fly as Mission Specialist 1 or Mission Specialist 2. We have flight engineers on the space station now working that could be military or could be non-military. So it's a kind of a mix of both.
Well, would you recommend that a student who's thinking about this go to flight school?
I think every student out there that's listening, you need to find out what you love to do, because it's nothing worse than trying to do something that you don't love. I love chemistry because my mother gave me a chemistry set when I was in seventh grade. OSHA hadn't certified that one because I created an explosion and, you know, blew the rug up in my mother's living room. But that fueled my curiosity and I became a chemistry major. So parents that are out there, find that thing that really turns your kids on. I mean, you know, your iPads, your iPhone, the technology that's out there now can help advance them in so many different ways. Hands-on experiential activities that they can do to Legos, building blocks. I mean, these things help them be little scientists and engineers at a very early age. So I think exposing them to those types of things early on will let them find that inner creativity, because some kids don't get that until much later on in life, when sometimes after seventh grade it's too late. We want to get to the high school students. We have things like Zero Robotics, where students can actually program in the cloud and actually compete and end up at MIT working with other kids around the world programming robotic spheres on the space station. So we have, that's one program, Zero Robotics. If you go to nasa.gov/education, you can see that program. Exploration Design Challenge is for high school students, K-12 students, but especially high school students that are looking to build a radiation shield that we're going to actually fly next year on the Orion capsule. So these are things that students can do right now, hands-on experiential, that helps us get our astronauts to Mars radiation-free.
Did I just hear you say that you're crowdsourcing ways to get to Mars?
Exactly. Because, I mean, when you think about the taxpayers, I mean, we're both taxpayers. We're spending $17 billion on NASA, you know, NASA to do this work, but it's the general public's data. You know, we have a big data movement. We have things where we have students that are doing space apps challenges. There's an iPhone app that I have now that looks at weather on Mars and weather on Earth that was grown in 2 days from kids and people around the world developing apps. So we have a rich data set, from Mars data to data of the ocean from our satellites looking at, you know, the oceans and the Earth, the planet. We can use all that data to help our civilization advance. And so I think students, kids, parents, you know, tap into nasa.gov/education or just nasa.gov to see what's out there. We have opportunities for parents where we have a program called SEMA, where we bring parents with their kids on the weekend, and we help train the parents, tell them what they need to do to help their kids. You don't have to be an engineer to raise an engineer. So these are the things your kids need to know about. Again, nasa.gov/education, fellowships and internships. If you go to intern.nasa.gov, high school students and college students can find out opportunities to come work at NASA for the summer. It's a paid internship. We'll pay your money, you know, room and board, housing, whatever, and you can come there and work beside world-renowned scientists and engineers. So you can see in your freshman year what it means to be an engineer, because we lose 60% of our kids out of the first and second year that are in STEM fields because they don't see the relevance of why they should take an intro chemistry class or intro statics class. And so we try to bridge that gap by that first and second year, giving them opportunities to actually use their hands in a lab and see what it is to work in a field like that.
That's terrific advice. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
If you would like additional information about Leland D. Melvin, please visit nasa.gov/education. If you have comments or suggestions about higher education today, please send an email to our viewer mailbox at highereducationtoday@topcolleges.com. Thank you for watching. We will continue to bring you quality discussions about important matters in today's college and university world. Please join me again for another edition of Higher Education Today. I'm Stephen Roy Goodman, and you've been watching Higher Education Today.